Yeah, welcome to everyone. It's great to see upwards of 100 views for this type of video. That's really good because we're covering territory here that isn't familiar. Most people are pretty familiar with non-dual teachers and teaching. I've been looking on YouTube on some of these teachers, as I occasionally do. And it always strikes me that, yes, it sounds great, but it's not quite all-inclusive, because it leaves out the explanation of why did this delusion, misidentification, why did that arise in the first place? Did it just come from nowhere for no reason? You know, it just leaves that untouched. So I've had to forge into that untouched territory to provide the big picture, all-inclusive picture of what's really going on. And not familiar territory for most. So it's great that we're able to at least break the ice here, even though in a small way I consider 100 views to be quite great. And so I'll make another video. I've been chased in from outside by the cold. It's actually cold in California right now. And the Giants are in the World Series now, unfortunately, to some extent, because it's fairly distracting for me. So I'm facing another possible 7-game series stretching into November 1st. But even so, I have to really forge ahead here, given that there's some response here to at least consider what's being said, which lays out the big picture of the situation we're in. Yes, non-dual teaching is part of it, for sure. But it's not all of it. It's not all of it. It's kind of like half of it, half the story. And so what we're hearing here is the rest of the story. How did this whole situation arise in the first place? Why? Why? You see, why did it arise? And we don't have to just shrug our shoulders and say, nobody knows. That is not true. Maybe nobody has cared to enough to know, to take in the time and effort to know. It's very difficult to get into this, because belief tries to block it. It's really tough. However, it's been done, and we can do it, and it's fairly simple. And you can start at the top, trickle-down certitude. You start at the top, and Prime Creator extended itself, expanded itself, and that's this expansion of itself is called Spirit. The Prime created, and Spirit expands as with God, the Prime Creator, as co-creators. The expansion expands as it were. Okay, but it's not reciprocal. You know, Spirit did not give rise to the Prime Creator through its expansion. Just like a parent gives rise to a child gives rise, grows up, gives rise to more children. So it creates as the Creator creates, but did not create the Creator. So Spirit wanted to create the Creator. It wanted to feel that it was the Prime Creator. And so as soon as it had this idea, what's called desire arose. Okay, because desire only arises with this idea, because it can't be experienced. So desire means something that has not yet been experienced. There's a desire to experience something. Okay, have an experience. If the idea and the experience were simultaneous, which they are in reality for all their ideas, then there's no place for desire to arise. There's no gap between choosing an idea or an experiencing and the experience. It's instantaneous. But in this case, Spirit cannot be Prime Creator, because the laws of creation are mutable and creation expands in one direction. So it's impossible for Spirit to be Prime Creator, so it can only desire to be so. And desire gives rise to time, okay? Meaning, not yet. In reality, there's no need for any time, because everything is instantaneous, right now. No gap. Direct experiencing right now. So there's no need for time whatsoever. And this idea of wanting to be Prime Creator also gives rise to what's called a belief system. A belief that there's a way to accomplish this. Given the desire and given time, there's a way to use time to accomplish the impossible. And so belief simply shows to spirit what seems to be a plausible way to accomplish the impossible, to literally change reality, because the way reality is immutable, and in this immutable reality, spirit is the creation of the prime creator. Okay, but spirit cannot be the creator of the prime creator. It's impossible. So spirit, in order to be the prime creator, would have to change reality. So belief, fundamental premise of belief is that reality can be changed. That's what it's there to tell spirit. Yes, we can. That's what belief says. Yes, we can. You spirit can become prime creator, can become, okay, through time, through process. If there's no process, how could there be any time? Consider that. If there's no process, everything is instantaneous. And so you can't point to any process. It's a complete seamless flow. Reality is completely seamless. Where is there process? There's only this seamless expansion. But in time, they're attempting to do the impossible, there is process. There seems to be A, B, C, D, you know, sequential, some type of process going on. Now, what is this process that is taking place in belief system, which we call existence, the universe, energy, all that? That's what arises as a belief system. That is belief showing spirit how spirit can become prime creator. And what belief is showing spirit is that there's a way to threaten reality. And the idea, the notion is that there's a way to force the prime creator to change reality and to make spirit prime creator. And the only way to force prime creator to do this is to be able to threaten reality and say, prime creator, if you don't change reality and make us prime creator, we are going to annihilate reality. Okay, so belief is presenting in time and process a plausible scenario of how reality can be threatened. Now, it can't be threatened right now, but belief keeps saying in the future, through this process, okay, not right now, but another step needs to be taken, a step in time, and more steps need to be taken. Eventually, we'll build up this power. Somehow, we're going to manufacture it, accumulate it, accumulate a power that can threaten reality with destruction. And the way we accumulate it, the way belief supposedly is accumulating this power, is through death. Okay? Ceaseless sacrifice. Everything that arises dies, or it changes. Everything is vulnerable within existence. Every last situation is vulnerable. Okay? This is, by looking at this vulnerability, spirit sees all this vulnerability and engages its attention there and says, wow, you know, it's the whole universe of vulnerability, and if the entire universe is vulnerable, it would seem like the reality itself could be vulnerable also, vulnerable to being changed, ultimately being annihilated, being killed, being rendered dead, nothing, you know. So spirit is not in this dream of existence. That's belief is the one generating this dream. Actually, it's mind that's generating it, and it's generating an imaginary hypothetical scenario we call belief. Okay, mind is the servant of spirit, and it doesn't have free will to choose which ideas to serve. Whatever idea spirit has, mind presents that experiencing. It's the presenter of experience. So it's presenting mind's desire to be prime creator as this belief system that we call time and space and existence, energy, the play of energy, dance of energy, dance of all that, ceaselessly changing. In other words, being vulnerable to change, because belief believes that reality is vulnerable to being changed. That's what it's presenting. So spirit keeps engaging. It's like watching a movie. Spirit keeps watching a movie, watching this, engaging with it, and paying attention to it. And as it pays attention to this, it doesn't realize what it is right now, because it's paying attention to what it can become, what it believes it can become. And it sees all this death and dying and sacrifice and devouring, self-devouring of the universe as the means to become prime creator. So it views this as a becoming of what it wants to be, and is unaware of what it is right now. So this is the part that non-duality doesn't get into at all. It leaves that alone. Non-duality then starts talking about the belief system, how belief has invented this I, this hero of the dream, this one to be sacrificed, and set up this symbol of an I, and it gets into all of that, which we also have gotten into and looked at that. But it's very important to put this, the non-dual talk about the I, the imaginary, non-existent, make-believe I, in the right context, within this belief system, and this belief system serving this idea that spirit chose. And the purpose of all this is to develop a way to destroy reality. It's not just all arising for no purpose. That is not true. It's serving the purpose. All effects serve a purpose, serve their cause. All effects. There's no such thing as effects without a cause. No such thing. Okay, so what these videos are giving is both parts of it. Both parts of it. And it seems to me that this is vitally important, vitally important. Once you see the big picture and start getting familiar with the big picture, the whole picture, the entire picture, then you have so much more leverage. And it seems like you're going to steamroll the whole thing, and you're not going to backslide. I've seen so many non-dual teachers have breakthroughs, and for some reason, it seems like over time they backslide. And it's probably because they don't quite have the whole situation in context, and there's some room for belief to play, and belief begins to undermine their situation. So they kind of lose the oomph that they had, you know, when they're at certain times they really seem to have it, and then later on they just see, it seems like they've kind of, you know, lost that. It's seeped away somehow, like there's a leak somewhere. And we don't want that. We don't want that. The great gurus, the sad gurus, the ones who have perfect certainty about that reality cannot be threatened in any way, cannot be changed in any way. They don't diminish over time here in the world. They don't. There's no leaks there. And you can tell when they were young, when they're middle-aged, when they're older, exactly the same. Exactly the same. No diminishment whatsoever. So having experience with these great teachers, these great saviors, looking at them and like Anandamayi or Ramana Maharshi, looking at their lives and recognizing, seeing that they were the same the whole way through their lives. Did no leaks at all, no diminishment at all. Of course, their bodies aged, but their certitude did not waver or flicker or diminish whatsoever. And they still had this profound, effortless peace that was just incredible, beyond belief is what it is. Whereas the non-dual teachers I've seen, they seem to deflate like a balloon that's pumped up with air, and over time the balloon gradually deflates like that, and it just doesn't have the plumpness, you know, that a full blown up balloon has. And I'm seeing it as possibly they don't have that other side of the story of why all this situation arose, and why we're so engaged with the delusion of belief, keep buying into belief. Because we want belief to be true. And until we actually realize this and choose a new idea instead of the idea of being prime creator, until we do that, we will be vulnerable to whatever realization we have to that being deflated over time. So that is why I speak up in these videos, and not in any way to disrespect any of the teachers here at all. Because there's no question that many of them have really seen through the I delusion that belief is believing in. Belief says that there's some identity in this. It's just bundled concepts is all it is. And that you're supposed to pay attention, engage with these bundles of concepts, bundled of thoughts, memories, concepts, all these bundlings, and that somehow this is you in the making. You know, this I is what is the hero that is eventually going to become greater than God, greater than reality, greater than the prime creator. But what belief is really doing is building up these bundles of concepts, saying that this is some very important step to be taken, and then destroying the bundle of concepts, scattering the bundle of concepts to the winds. In other words, there's constructivity and then destructivity. Belief gives in order to take away. Belief gives in order then to attack what is given, and to then mine data on how the defenses, how that bundled a bundle of concepts defends itself from attack. And then believing that this is information, data on how reality defends itself, that then we can find a way to get past those defenses and threaten reality. But the truth is that reality has no defenses. So all of this work on defenses, on overcoming defenses, is a waste of time, complete waste of time. We keep building up all sorts of stuff, whatever it may be, you know, people, bodies, of all types. And this has to do with everything that has arisen in existence. It arises so that it can be attacked. It's vulnerable. And everything has its defenses too, doesn't it? Every microorganism, you know, they all have defenses. Look at the viruses that are so clever. You know, we can't find ways to, you know, get rid of these viruses because they have incredibly clever defenses. Okay, even on the very, you know, that level of microorganisms and viruses, etc., the defenses are very sophisticated. And then here we are, you know, working on finding a way to penetrate those defenses and kill the virus. Now, humans take a very important role in this belief system. Now, belief believes there's some God that made humans and put humans here and everything. It was belief that has done all of this, that has imagined all of this. And then belief tells us that this imaginary, this make-believe God views us as all-important. Human bodies, body minds, is like the supreme, you know, creation. It's very important. Why? Because humans have tremendous capability to both build defenses and penetrate defenses. Very destructive. Humans are destroying the planet right now and everything on it. And belief, that is exactly what belief wants. Belief has made these body minds to do exactly that, to be extremely destructive as well as extremely constructive. Humans have built up 7 billion people on the planet with all this intricate infrastructure only so that it can also destroy all of that. And it's destroying the ecosystems of the planet. It's destroying the animal kingdom. It's pillaging the planet. And human body minds are profoundly destructive, which is why belief invests in them so greatly and praises them and says, this is my greatest creation, you know. Humans are the greatest because they're the most destructive. I mean, we have the ability to destroy everything on the planet. We can produce, you know, unbelievable destructivity. And that's a belief just, you know, they're so proud of that, so proud of that. And yet, again, we are spirit. We're not body minds. Body mind has absolutely nothing to do with what we are. But we are engaging with this movie of existence because we believe we want it to be true. We want it to succeed. We want it to develop into a way to threaten reality so that the prime creator has to change reality, which, by the way, the prime creator cannot change reality. It's immutable. Cannot change it. So it's a complete waste of time. But engaging with this movie of existence is a total waste of time. All time is a waste of time. it simply is futile. It's futile. So we don't really need to engage with these body minds, this bundling of concepts that we call the body mind. They don't need to be, you know, we don't have to engage with the cleverness, the building up, the tearing down. We don't need to be clever humans building stuff up and then defending it. We don't need to identify with the movie at all because nothing is really happening. Nothing is happening. if we see it from that standpoint, that the that there is no way to threaten reality, then this movie can just lose all interest from that standpoint. All the parameters are still there. You can still see, you know, what's going on, but it's like an empty shadow play, something like that, where the realization is that it's a complete nothing, absolute zero. So this is something that we're working towards, disengaging with belief, moving towards, gravitating towards choosing a new idea, which gives rise to an overlay of unconditional love over all of belief, everything that belief has believed in. Belief has given rise to everything that we see, everything that body, mind see, everything that's being perceived has been belief has given rise to all of that. It's belief that has given rise to all of this, everything that we're perceiving. Reality is not perceived, it is directly experienced. Prime Creator did not give rise to perception or that which is perceived. Okay, it is belief that has given rise to everything that is perceived. The planets, the solar systems, the galaxy, the universe, and everything in it. It's perceived. It's energy. Energy is perceived, and that is belief has given rise to all of that. So when we talk about disengaging, we're not talking about disengaging from one belief, like a particular belief. We're talking about disengaging from belief itself, but even more importantly, from that which gives rise to belief, which we would say is desire. The Buddha would say is desire, but even more important than that, choosing a new idea, because it's the idea that gave rise to desire. Remember? Choosing a new idea is really the ultimate cure. It is the only cure there is. Because we could not experience being Prime Creator that had to give rise to this delaying mechanism called desire, where it projects the experience into the future. It cannot be experienced now directly. So desire says, it's going to be experienced in the future. Not now, but in the future. So belief then keeps producing this future. It's pretty simple. When you see it, you say, is it that simple? It is. It's absolutely that simple. But ultimately, we have to gravitate towards choosing a new idea. And this overlay, unconditional love, which is the idea of not trying to be Prime Creator, which means not trying to develop any threat, which means not trying to change reality, not trying to develop a threat to change reality, a way to threaten Prime Creator. In other words, just allowing everything to be exactly as it is, not trying to become something different. And that is overlay is every moment, every instant, the effect of that idea is simply overlays everything in time and space, and every situation, and allows it to be exactly what it is without any desire to change it every single moment. Because there's no desire for there to be some future, right? To desire to change reality gives rise to future, because you can't experience it now. But if you don't desire to change reality, you have no desire to change reality, that doesn't give rise to a future. It only gives rise to a right now as it is-ness. And that right now as it is-ness overlays moment by moment by moment everything that arises in belief. And it's not trying to stop anything from rising, not trying to change anything that arises. Just accepting everything as it is right now, overlaying it all, and anything that could ever possibly arise in quote-unquote the future, that too is accepted as it is without any desire to change it, make it different. No desire for changing anything, not even change. And this is what the great gurus, the sadgurus have, is you cannot recognize that. They feel like they're just accepting. There's a total acceptance beyond belief. It's some kind of transcendent acceptance, unconditional acceptance. It's a different type of acceptance as what belief tells us we're supposed to cultivate. It's not an acceptance of the now. It is simply the idea of not trying to change reality gives rise to this effect, which is effortless, seamless, unconditional love. They're not trying to give rise to this. It automatically arises. It's effortless for them. It's not an effort. It's not a struggle at all. So there's no way to deflate it. Once a new idea has been chosen, the idea of not trying to be prime creator, then there's no deflation. The effect arises and the effect is unchangeable. So how could it deflate? It cannot deflate. It's only one effect, and it's the effect of not trying to change anything, including itself. It's not trying to change what it is. So it remains as it is. That effect remains as it is. So we can either experience this effect, the effect as it is, an effect that is not trying to change itself at all, that is unchanging, or we don't experience it. We experience that a future. And experiencing a future is deflating. And what many do perhaps is they want to experience unconditional love in the future. They may have seen unconditional love and they say, okay, I'm almost there. And they let time into it a little bit, and gradually it deflates. It's a deflation sort of thing. And the deflation is there from the very beginning, but it's a gradual deflation. It's a gradual deflation. So as to be almost unnoticeable, perhaps. Maybe it's a way of just tricking people, and they don't realize they're being deflated. They don't realize they haven't yet chosen a new idea. So they gradually deflate over time. And when you're aging, you hardly notice it. Other people, let's say they haven't seen you in 10 years. They see you and say, oh my gosh, you know, you've really aged. Whereas you think, no, I look just like I did yesterday. So age is a very insidious thing. And if we do not choose a new idea, whatever insights we have, those will age. They will age. Whereas if we do choose a new idea, that unconditional love doesn't age. For instance, Anandamayi Ma, her body aged, just like all bodies here, it aged. But the presence did not age at all. Did not age at all. There are those who knew her when she was young, and they knew her when she was old. And they said, you know, her body was old and like getting really old. But they would come to her and suddenly they would realize and experience totally that as if she was just a young person, and they recognized that the presence was exactly the same, hadn't changed in the slightest bit. But the assumption was because the body was getting older that somehow the presence was deflating too. It actually was not at all. So this is the situation that we need to be aware of, and we need to realize that this is the actual goal, is to choose a new idea, new causal agent. Anything less than that and belief will still be tricking us with time, saying, yeah, we're almost there, we need to let it mature, you know, need to mature, the realization needs to mature. Now, there is a getting comfortable, moving our comfort zone. That is something that does usually need to take place, but we need to be consciously aware of what the goal is and to keep on moving in that direction instead of taking it that we've arrived. You know, we've arrived. Because if we've arrived, the unconditional love would be effortless. It would just be there. It would be there like the air that we're breathing, even more there than the air we're breathing. And being with that would be more effortless than breathing for us, more effortless. It would simply, there's no effort at all. It simply is there. In all times, all places. Yogananda said of Anandamayi Ma, he said, it's unbelievable because in all circumstances, her perfect peace was there. In all circumstances, whether, you know, walking, riding in a car, conversing, eating, any situation, it was exactly the same. And he marveled at that, saying, wow, because it's effortless, because it's an effect of an idea. The idea of not trying to be prime creator, of accepting reality as it is. And that gives rise to simply an effect that is as it is and doesn't change. It's unchanging. It's not like she had to work to prevent it from changing. No work was required whatsoever to prevent it from changing. But of course, belief believes that it can do this too. It cannot. And we've gone over that many times, how belief just continually generates lies after lie after lie after lie, belief after belief, believing that it can, whatever it needs to do, whatever we want it to be, it can be that. That is simply not true. Belief cannot be a different effect. It cannot change what it is. Belief is the effort to change what is. The belief that it can change what it is, which is impossible. And belief will always believe it can change what it is. I need to keep on putting this on the front burner, that belief will always believe it can change what it is. So belief can believe, will believe that whatever you want it to be, it can be that. If you want it to be unchanging, it can be that. Not true. But it can seem, it can give us a belief in this, to the point where it may seem like we've arrived at unchangeableness. And then, of course, belief will inevitably change it, gradually change it. Sometimes it can change it fast, it can change it slow. I mean, look at all the change in the universe, all the different speeds of change, right? Belief is the master of change, of vulnerability, and it does it in all sorts of different ways and time frames. So it can be very gradual or very abrupt. So all of this is worth noting without passing judgment on anybody at all. It certainly is worth noting that the real goal for us, the responsibility we cannot escape, is to choose a new causal agent, which gives rise to this effortless, unconditional love, peace beyond understanding, effortless. And up until that point, we are still, to some extent, wanting belief to be true, wanting belief to be true, that what it says it can find a way for us to satisfy that desire that we have, that unfulfilledness. Desire is like an unfulfilled, it's like a not experiencing what we want. There's an experience out there I want, but I don't have it yet. Well, when spirit shows the idea of wanting to be prime creator, that's exactly the experiencing it gets. It gets this unfulfilled craving, like it doesn't have what it wants. And so spirit wants to find a way to get rid of this desire. But when it comes to the idea of wanting to be prime creator, spirit cannot get rid of that desire. The desire automatically gives rise to this belief system that there's a way to get rid of this desire. And belief system, yeah, we're working on it. It's in the future. And you just have to keep waiting for it. It's not now. It's never. But the thing is, it's never now. It's never now. It's always in the future. The fulfillment of that desire, the getting rid of that desire, is always in the future. It's never right now. Right now, it's unfulfilled. We feel the desire. It's the cravings are still there. And we keep trying to, belief keeps putting up these, believed in desires to distract us. Like we want this or this or this or this, or that, this and that. And no, what we really want is to be prime creator, and we cannot have that. So the desire remains with this idea, and the belief system remains with this idea, always. And no matter what belief says, or what belief believes it can get rid of desire, belief believes it can change what it is, what purpose it serves, it can change what it is, it can become unchangeable, it can become enlightened, it can become anything we want. None of that is true. None of that is true at all. Belief always remains what it is, which is the belief in impermanence, the belief in vulnerability, the belief in being able to change what is. And it's just a pathological liar. Never stops lying. It never stops believing. Belief never stops believing. You cannot stop belief from believing. You can only stop belief from arising in the first place by choosing a new idea, a different idea, than trying to be prime creator, trying to change reality. As long as we are entertaining the idea of wanting to change reality, even in the tiniest bit, we keep thinking, saying, oh, we only wanted to change a little tiny bit. Remember, reality is immutable. Therefore, if you could change it even in the tiniest bit, you've entirely changed it and nullified it. Because it's very, what reality is this immutability, is this certainty, certitude. You cannot have certitude and incertitude both. You cannot have 99% perfect certitude. It's not possible. Either that there's the perfect certitude or there isn't. Either something is immutable or it isn't. There's no third option. It's not both immutable and mutable. It's not possible. This is what belief doesn't understand at all. It insists that that this is not true. And when you bring this up for belief, belief just kind of like thinks you're crazy, doesn't know what to say. You know, in other words, belief has no response, so it just, all it says is, well, you must be crazy. And it's belief that's crazy. Because believing that something can be immutable and also mutable is crazy, right? That's insanity. It's belief that's insane, not reason. Reason is not insane. And so listening to reason is very important. And reason simply states that you cannot have, that cannot be both immutable and mutable. You cannot have that both in the same place, you know, in the same place. It's not possible. You cannot have endlessness and an end in the same place, can you? It cannot both be true. If you're talking about a situation, it cannot both be true. A situation cannot be endless and also have an end. It cannot be immutable and also be mutable. It cannot be true and also be a lie. It has to be one or the other. It cannot be both. And this is the undoing of belief. The more that you focus on this, the more you disengage from belief and you realize what it is, which is the belief that it can change what it is. It can change what is. That it somehow can change what is and make it anything it wants it to be. In other words, it believes it can make something both immutable and mutable, you know, at the same time, right now. But if something is immutable, how can the future touch it? Cannot. So you have to believe, just simply believe in the future, it will be mutable, but that's simply a belief. It's a projection away from right now, from what is, into something imaginary. The belief is just the play of imagination. We're imagining that reality could be different than what it is. There's this imagination, there's this belief that this is possible. And so we're overlooking, we're denying what is the case. Actually the case, which is right now and always and forever. We're believing that there's a beyond forever, which there isn't. So we keep on looking at this, keep on looking at it, and that brings about gradual disengagement with belief. Backing away from it. It's kind of like backing away from the edge of an abyss. And gradually do it. You don't want to move too abruptly because you're afraid you might be clumsy and awkward and fall and go over the abyss. So you take baby steps away. Gradually your steps get a little stronger as you back away from this abyss of really insanity. That's all it is. Belief is really insanity. Total insanity. Belief is completely insane, completely merciless too. Completely without any real mercy at all. Because what is mercy except to choose a new idea? Belief can't do that. Belief insists it can provide spirit with what spirit really wants within belief, within insanity, within the belief that both truth and lies can both be true, that something can be immutable and mutable, that spirit can be find what it really wants there. But of course, belief, it believes that what spirit really wants is this desire to be fulfilled. And yet spirit has to recognize that this desire can never be fulfilled. It's just unfulfillment. This idea of wanting to be prime creator is simply the experience of unfulfillment. It's like a non-experience. And it's so terrible, you can only experience it for an instant. But what spirit did was it felt this was so terrible, and it said, oh my gosh, I don't want to feel this, you know, at all. So then it gave rise to this vast, you know, this belief system that seems to keeps projecting as if there's a way to experience this desire without a suffering, you know, without rejecting it. But the fact is that the most that spirit can experience this desire is just for a moment, and then it has to reject it. And this gets into even deeper teaching. We don't have to jump into that at this point. You can work with this and see it in your own insights. One second here. Now, it's not always wise to try and dig even deeper into some of the details. Maybe just note them. But the most important thing is to see the big picture. See the total picture instead of the details of the picture. Because what happens if you get lost in the details, you'll forget the big picture of what's in this. A big picture that's important, because it's choosing a new idea that's important. And if we're obsessed about details, about the I, about belief, and all this kind of stuff, we may forget that, hey, what we need to do ultimately is simply to choose the idea of not trying to be prime creator, not desiring to... not wanting to change reality. And that's ultimately where we have to get to. So it's best not to get too wrapped up in any details, even though it may seem that those who... Okay, I'm getting the interruptions. And okay, those who dig into the details, it may seem as if they are more into it than those who are trying to look at the big picture and not get into too much detail. And they may think, wow, you know, I'm just sort of painting general strokes and seeing the big thing, and others are like in the minutiae, really generating all this minutiae. But it's just the opposite. The ones who are generating all this minutia are the ones who are going very slow, and they're afraid of looking at the big picture, thinking that something, you know, they're afraid of it. And so they're trying to go as slow as possible, taking tiny, 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 tiny steps. And then kind of, you know, saying, hey, look at all these tiny, tiny, tiny steps I'm taking. I took like a million steps, tiny steps. And someone who's looking at the big picture, they might take, you know, in 10 steps, they may cover the same ground that someone else has taken a million steps to cover. So it's very helpful to keep painting the big picture, although it's also possible to paint too big of a picture, which is what I feel a lot of non-dual teaching does, is it discards too much in the effort to make a big leap right now, just a big leap. It is like trying to take a leap back from the edge of the abyss instead of backing away from it gradually. So there's kind of a medium middle path there between being too obsessed about details and trying to just discard all details altogether. There is a middle path. I think that the Buddha spoke about the middle path being the best path. And this is what it's about, is you don't want to go to either extreme too much. And going to an extreme is a fear-based kind of thing. You kind of swing between too detailed oriented and just trying to throw everything away, saying, forget it. I don't need to know anything about it. I just need to jump, that kind of thing. Now, occasionally, some may jump. They may jump back from the abyss, occasionally. But generally speaking, that doesn't happen. The fear is much too great for that. So what we try to do is we try to bring up some detail, but only to advance the narrative. Keep saying, okay, here's some detail, but also here is the big picture. Here's the big picture. And so I always try to bring up the big picture along with any details that might arise. We have lots of details coming up in the world. There's no question about it. The future is always full of trauma. Always. It's always full of sacrifice. It's always full of death. Right? I mean, when has the future ever not been full of death in existence? It's always chock full of it. Decay. Everything that is made is decaying, is aging, is heading towards destruction, everything. And there's these cycles that can belief that just keep going on and on and on, constructivity, destructivity. And there's, you know, there's endless details to all of that, endless details. Some of them have some relevance in the big picture, meaning that they can undermine our conviction, our willingness to gravitate towards choosing a new idea. They very well could do that. So there is some relevance to that. But it's not that helpful to get into the nitty-gritty of what's going to happen. Because I'll tell you what it is, it's simply trauma. As a matter of fact, the entire time that we have been engaged with belief can be characterized by simply, it was a time spent in trauma, engaging with trauma. That's it. And the time that when we're free of that, we're engaging with bliss, unconditional love. So we're really either in engaged with unconditional love or we're engaged with trauma. That's it. So you might ask, you know, how has your life been? And you say, well, just is this, you know, some odd number of years I've been engaged with trauma. And then when you drop that, choose unconditional love, then you can say, well, and now I'm engaged with unconditional love. It's really that cut and dry, that black and white, that simple. You don't have to detail all the trauma, the different types of trauma. Just simply one word to describe them all is simply trauma. But engaged with trauma. That's all that belief is. Belief ceaselessly traumatizes itself. That's why I say belief has no mercy upon itself. It's merciless. Belief is merciless to itself. Will always be merciless to itself. Its very purpose is to generate this supposed threat to reality, constantly traumatizing itself. Which is no real trauma at all. But to belief, it is a trauma. Belief believes it's being traumatized. Belief believes it's a real trauma. So if we're watching this movie, we are like in a nightmare because belief believes that this trauma is real. And we're like afraid of fear. We're fearful of it. We're afraid. We're experiencing fear. Jesus said we either experience fear or love, which is true. And trauma is really this root fear. Fear that reality can be threatened in some way. And when we recognize that reality cannot be threatened, then we experience love. Love is simply reality, knowing that it cannot be threatened. Certitude. Absolute certitude. And these, again, are big picture explanations, which are crucial. The better you're able to accept the big picture explanation, the faster you're backing away from that abyss. That nightmare, that movie, that's a nightmare. A lot of people like to watch movies that are extremely traumatic, which is exactly what, you know, that's what belief wants. I've always found I've been repulsed by that. I'm repulsed by trauma of every type. I have an abhorrence for it, you know. And it's just always amazing to me that people actually, you know, are engaging with these, you know, dramatic movies, etc. It's just like, wow. But that's what belief is all about. And belief praises itself for engaging with that. It's really belief that's engaging with it. It's just that spirit is engaging with the movie. You know, belief is producing the movie. Spirit is watching the movie. Actually, belief is producing the movie, and belief is also producing the viewer of the movie, and then spirit is engaged with the watcher of the movie and the movie, both. It's watching the watcher and the movie as well. It's watching both. So the eye is could be in some references it could be the watcher of the movie, but that eye is also being produced by belief. And ultimately, you have spirit, which is engaged with everything that belief is doing, however you want to explain it, because it wants it to be true. See, this is the bottom line. Let's cut right to the bottom line. Spirit wants it to be true. That is the price that spirit is paying for entertaining this idea of wanting to be prime creator, is it ends up wanting what belief is doing to become true. And in wanting it to be true, it there's this attachment to it, this engagement with it. This is something that is not brought up enough at all in the teachings of this world. I've noticed the teachings of this world have a lot of significant gaps because belief puts those gaps there. And it's tough to recognize these gaps because in order to do it, you have to put the entirety of the situation together. And you have to really work on recognizing that you cannot have that which is immutable and immutable both. You cannot have which is endless and has an end both. You cannot have which is true and a lie both. Can't be both. And the more you work with that, the more you're able to see these gaps, as it were, that belief has maintained. That keep spirit engaging with belief, because spirit wants all the goal to be reached, and belief is just a means to that goal. But belief, because the goal can't be reached, the end as seems to be, the means seems to be an end in itself. But belief keeps hiding this. But really, belief is the end of this idea of wanting to be prime creator. Belief is the end of it. That's where it ends. Doesn't go beyond belief at all. Does not go beyond belief. But belief keeps presenting this movie as if there is going to be a resolution, an endpoint reached that is beyond belief. That is not true. And it keeps saying there's some ascension, there's some transcendence, there's all that you become a star, you become this, you become that. That is all within belief. That is belief keep continuously presenting something that it believes is beyond belief and saying that is what you're going to reach, and it's and belief is just a means to reach this end. But the fact is that belief is an end in itself. This is the booby prize, and that's all there is. Belief is the booby prize, and that's all there is to this idea of wanting to be prime creator. There isn't anything other than belief. That's the sum total of it. Belief cannot generate anything that is beyond belief. It is reality itself that is beyond belief. And that never arises within belief. Just truth does not arise as an effect of lies. Immutability does not come from mutability. Endlessness does not arise from an end to endlessness. And yet belief keeps stringing us along, saying there's some pot of gold, the end of the rainbow of belief. Belief is like a rainbow and keeps telling us that the pot of gold is at the end of this rainbow if we just keep pursuing this rainbow. Just like that, belief is like that. And no matter how you move towards that rainbow, slowly or quickly, it always recedes into the future. So you can look at a rainbow and you think, okay, I want to get there. So if you start going fast, like in a car, you realize it keeps moving and it keeps its distance. And you think, wait a minute, how about if I go real slowly, like crawl towards it or step, baby steps real slowly toward the rainbow? Maybe I can reach it that way, you see. So there are many belief keeps presenting these different ways to supposedly arrive at this endpoint of belief, which is beyond belief. And sometimes, you know, it presents, you know, go fast, sometimes go slow, real, real slow, and all different speeds in between. And yet none of it will ever arrive at a resolution beyond beyond belief. Within belief, belief generating something, some ultimate outcome that is what spirit wants from belief. Spirit cannot give, belief cannot give spirit what spirit desires, which is to be prime creator, which is to change reality, which is, cannot give spirit that. But belief keeps saying it can, it believes it can, and keeps projecting that success into the future. And it will say, it will tell us whatever we want to hear about all sorts of success in the future. You know, it's going to be a great future. Whereas reason and reality and truth will tell us the only way to use time successfully is to free yourself from the belief that time can be used successfully. The only way to use belief is to recognize that that belief cannot go beyond belief. It cannot change what it is. So the right use of time is to recognize there is no right use of time. It's to disengage from the movie, that no amount of engagement in this movie is going to give us what we desire. And so success isn't in the future. Success is here right now with accepting everything as it is, which, of course, would be right now. If we're accepting everything as it is, how could that acceptance be in the future? Because that would be a gap, wouldn't it, between right now and our acceptance. So to accept everything as it is would have to be right now. If we truly accepted everything as it is, how could it be in the future? Again, how could it be in the future? Because in order to be in the future, it means that we're not accepting everything as it is right now. And there's something wrong with there's a lack of acceptance of everything right now, but the acceptance will come in the future. So how is that acceptance of everything as it is? If we accept everything as it is, that inherently means right now. Inherent in that acceptance, totally inherent. And so this is what reason can point out to us. Very simple, has to be that way. And this is what belief overlooks. When you get on the path of choosing a new idea, what happens is you start to see what belief overlooks. You start to recognize and say, wait a minute, you know, hey. You know, there's a problem right here. It just completely overlooked, you know, what must be true. Just kind of, you know, whistled right past it. And you just start catching all this chicanery of belief, how it just ignores truth. Ignores this fact that acceptance of what is has to be now. Belief just overlooks that and says, yeah, we're going to get that. And not now, but in the future. We're almost there. Which is, you know, delusional. Can never be almost there. Acceptance of what is can never be almost there. It has to be here now. It is simply that we are believing what belief tells us about it. In other words, we're engaged with belief means we want belief to be true. That is the problem. So we continue to engage with it and accept its explanation. And therefore wait for its answer. Wait for it to deliver what we really want. In other words, deliver this acceptance of everything, unconditional acceptance of isness, what everything is, isness right now, unconditional acceptance of everything. We're waiting for that, for belief to deliver that to us, which is never now. So we never get it. Because when we ask for it now, belief will say, well, what do you mean now? It's in the future. And we say, well, I've been waiting for it for so long. And belief says, well, yeah, but it's just you just haven't quite reached it yet. How can acceptance of everything as it is have a future? How can it reach into the future? There is no future for that acceptance. It's always right now. There's no gap in that. There's no movement out of that. And so reason is just seeing this and showing it. It's showing it to me. It's being shown to me by reason, just by looking, be willing to look at it. And some of the viewers here are actually looking within and looking at their own insights, and that's what you have to do. You have to have your own process, own situation, where you look at what seems to be an insurmountable obstacle and confusion, and let reason simply present it to you. And then you see it. You say, oh my gosh, I never saw that before. That's what reason does. And you start out by believing that you can't get it, because getting it is always in the future. You can't get it right now. But reason will show it to you right now. You'll get it. And you say, aha, I see it. Now I see it. Meaning I'm seeing it now. I'm seeing that truth is true now. Truth is not something that will become true. Endlessness is endless right now. It's not something that will become endless. Immutability is immutable right now. It's not something that will become immutable. And yet if we want belief to be true, we want it's the outcome that we want from it to happen, we will continue to engage with this belief that what we want can be given to us in the future. What we really want is reality. And reality is immutable, meaning it's immutable right now. Doesn't have a future. Doesn't need a future. Time is meaningless to reality. Completely meaningless. 100% meaningless. And yet it's totally meaningful to belief. So that is really, you know, an enormous difference. Belief has 100% belief in time. Reality has zero need for time. Zero. Absolute. Reality completely ignores time, and it's beyond ignore. It simply knows that the whole question of time never even arises for it. It doesn't even ignore it. Doesn't even know it's ignoring it. It is a zero. It's less than zero. I mean, it's just there is no need for it whatsoever. And therefore, the concept, the notion of time never arises for reality. Since it never arises, it never needs to be put, you know, dealt with or looked at or any judged or anything. It's only belief. Only belief believes in time. And belief serves the effort to get rid of this desire, and the desire arises from spirit wanting to be prime creator, which it cannot experience. And you see how this, the reason makes it simple. Belief says, no, it can never be simple. It cannot be simple like that, because why? It's in the future, and you haven't arrived yet. So how can you say it's that simple? Because the future is mysterious, right? You never know what's going to happen, so we can't. Belief says, no, the future can't be known. So how can you say you know? Again, you know. Knowing means right now. There's no doubt. You know. And belief rejects that, saying you can't know, because who knows the future, you know? And the truth is, nobody knows the future, because you never arrive at it. You can know events that are going to happen as they happen now. You can say in the now moment that is to come, in the moment that is to come, that hasn't yet arrived, but is going to happen. That's different than the future. The future is by belief is a different situation, and we confuse those two. Like I say, you can know like what is going to happen in the quote unquote future, events that have not yet taken place within belief, but will. But as far as the outcome that we are seeking, that's always in the future, meaning it hasn't yet happened, it will never happen, but belief covers that up by saying it hasn't yet happened because it's in the future. Sure, you can know dramatic events that are coming, but that's not what we really want. can easily see. Ananda Maima said that she could see everything that in the future, crystal clear. And it is possible. If you have no desire to change anything, then the future is completely open book. If you allow everything to be exactly as it is, you have zero. There's no desire to change anything at all. Then literally the future becomes a totally open book. It already is. You know, it's trauma. And the various forms of trauma that belief have lined up, you know, is marching. You can say, well, these are the, right now, these are the beliefs that are marching. Because there's no space or time to this type of vision. The way that we, you know, believe in space and time. It's like you have this army is marching, you know, and you can say, okay, this first soldier will reach this milestone at this point. The next soldier will reach, you know, as they march along a single file, the next soldier will reach this mark, you know, the 1 mile mark at this point, and they'll mark, you know, and you can just chronologically, in time, I mean, chronological time is just markers and milestones of all the movements of within belief. Those can be seen right now. The entirety, actually, of everything that's going to happen can be seen right now. If there's zero desire to change anything, everything exactly as it is, then actually the entirety can be seen. But, again, belief cannot give us what we want belief to give us. And so it always puts that into the future. In other words, belief insists it can make both the immutable mutable. It can be both. And that can never happen. So belief says, well, that's going to happen in the future. In other words, the impossible, belief tells us the impossible is possible. And so it says it will happen in the future. But what actually happens is trauma. See, so you can see what's actually going to happen, but you can never see what can never happen, because it won't happen. But if you want it to happen, you will continue to engage with the trauma, believing that this is leading towards this impossible happening. Somewhere in the future, as it were, has not yet taken place. But if you know it can never take place, then there's no need reason to believe in any sequentiality at all. You can see the totality of the situation, all is one. You don't need the no. But if you want it to be true and want it, the impossible to be accomplished, you have to believe in process. You have to go along with belief saying there's process and there's sequentiality to it. And therefore you recognize, you accept that you can't see the outcome. It's buried, it's a mystery. And then you're told that you have to engage fully with the sequence. And therefore you will be blind to all the trauma that's coming. Because you buy into belief's notion that by fully engaging with the trauma right now, the sequencing of it is all important. And if you somehow look ahead, you're screwing up the sequence. And belief says, you can't do that. You're going to mess up the process. And of course, the process never arrives at the product. So how can you say it's being messed up? Again, Ananda Maima said, and her actions gave ample proof of this as a fact, could see everything crystal clear ahead of time. And she said you could see to the end of, you know, just everything that could ever happen, it was all right now, can be seen. It's just that the sequentiality that belief is engaging in, this chicanery of thinking that it's all sequential, time is sequential, you know, it's just a belief. All the tricks that belief has up its sleeve are actually already present in belief. Already present in belief. All the trauma is already present in belief. But it just keeps feeding it to us sequentially, because it has to feed this storyline that we are in a process of arriving at this threat to reality, and that it can never point to the actual arriving. So it can only point to the process of arriving. That's it. and then hide the fact there is no arriving by insisting that we've somehow interfered with it if we peek too far ahead, because it knows if we peek ahead, we'll see there is no arriving. We say, wait a minute, I'm not going to arrive this life or the next or the next or the next, you know, and we'll say, wait a minute, I don't see any arriving at all. So it desperately tries to keep us from peeking ahead and seeing what is to come, the trauma that is to come, because it knows we will not ever see the arriving. It knows that there is no arriving. It feels threatened that we do that. It's a tremendous threat. It doesn't know it. It feels threatened. If I want to be precise with language, it believes that there's an arriving. But when we look ahead, it gets very threatened. It just feels this free floating anxiety threat, severe threat that, there's some extreme threat here, which is of course simply spirit recognizing there is no arriving. So belief is useless to give us what we really want. At least entertaining this idea to give us this experience of this idea. Belief is entirely useless. And when we start looking ahead and seeing, as again, when I was young, I was clairvoyant, very, very, very clairvoyant. It's a natural thing when you're not engaged with belief so much. It's very natural you become clairvoyant and you can see ahead. And I could see ahead, I could see all the trauma that's coming. And I just would say, hey, you know, here's this trauma, and then this one, and this. And belief was terribly threatened by that. And then when I finally said, wow, you know, maybe I'm not being compassionate or something, and slipped into belief, engaging with belief to a greater extent, I ended up, you know, experiencing the free-floating anxiety of belief that in this, you know, capability to see ahead terribly. Belief feels tremendously threatened by this. And of course, if you see ahead what traumas belief has scheduled, belief can always shuffle the scheduling just to try and make you seem to be inaccurate, but the fact is all that trauma is still on the plate. It can shuffle the cards in a deck, but it cannot change the cards in the deck that it's holding. Cannot. And so sometimes when you see something that belief has on deck, belief will go for a pinch hitter, you know, and say, okay, I'm going to put this hitter to the bench and bring in another hitter. And belief will say, ah, ha, ha, you see how wrong you were? See how wrong you were? But I say, no. I saw that this is the trauma that you had on deck and we're going to bring in the fact by bringing it up and giving, you know, showing this is what's coming. That belief felt so threatened by that belief then had to change it. And yet that it just simply moved it back in sequence a little bit. That's all. Still there. But that does happen. Belief feels so threatened by seeing what's ahead that it will go to great lengths. If anyone prophesizes or says something's going to happen, it will try to at least change the sequencing of it enough to try to discredit any seeing ahead. Because again, if we started seeing ahead and could see what's going on, we would say, wait a minute, where is the result? Where is the product that you've promised us? Where is it? I don't see it. All I see is trauma. Because if the fact is, when you look ahead, instead of saying this and this and this is going to happen, the fact is, everything that's going to happen in the future is simply trauma. That's it. And whatever we're given, future gives us, the future will take away from us. The sequencing will take away from us. So the details of exactly what's going to happen, those seem to be fluid, even though there are certain major things that are going to happen that belief simply cannot shuffle. It can shuffle the timing sometimes a little bit. It can shuffle various things, but there's also certain situations that it really cannot shuffle. That are so important to belief that it just simply has to go forward with it and disguise it as best as possible. But there have been a lot of people who have seen what belief has on deck, and then belief has somehow shuffled it and changed it a bit, and then people felt discredited, like, oh, maybe this seeing is somehow faulty or wrong. No, it's not. In some cases, it can be, but in other cases, it's not. And really, there's nothing that seems to threaten belief more than to see what is coming and the trauma and this and see the situation as it is. You see, everybody's going to die. You know, everybody's going. You know, all this stuff's going to happen, et cetera, et cetera. Because that's always been true. Everyone's going to die. Everyone that's been born here is born to die. But if you really see it all, then you say, wait a minute, you know, where is the product, you know, that I really want? It's not here in the future at all. If it's not in the future, where could it possibly be? It's not here right now, and it's not in the future. And then belief, you know, just poof, it's lost its hold. We're not engaging with it anymore. So it's actually those who see the future as traumatic who are closer to choosing a new idea than those who keep seeing it as, oh, it's wonderful, Pollyanna lollipops, you know. Sunshine, rainbows, and lollipops in the future. Now, the future is always traumatic, will always be traumatic. Belief can only give rise to trauma, can only give rise to fear. That's it. It can, you know, dress fear up in all sorts of different ways and then define the wardrobe that it's dressed in as love or spirituality or something like that. But it's still nothing other than trauma and fear. It's just that one wardrobe will differ from another wardrobe, like dressing a skeleton up and then debating about the wardrobe the skeleton is wearing, which is, you know, folly, complete folly. And that's what all that belief is doing. It is simply engaging in this massive, endless debate about wardrobes, you know. What wardrobe is the skeleton of belief wearing? And how does it differ from another wardrobe? And the minutiae of all these differences, which are completely meaningless. It's all exactly the same. It's all the presentation of futility, presentation of impossibility, the deception of imagining there's some product at the end of all this that will be able to threaten reality. No such product. Reality cannot be threatened. Because only God created the real, and only the real is real. And the real cannot threaten itself at all, because it's not the will of God that it be able to do so. So where could the threat possibly come from? Can't come from anywhere. Belief says it's going to come from nowhere. There is no such thing as nowhere. Okay? There's no such thing as nothing. There's no such thing as nowhere. Anything like that, that is simply the mysteries of belief, you know, made up, fanciful belief. There's no origin other than the Prime Creator. That's it. Everything flows from that. Creation has this directional flow, directional expansion. So here we are, just, you know, looking at the situation. Just looking at it. That's all. Just looking at it. We're not expecting belief to give us something from this looking. Because it won't. It won't. It will promise us all sorts of stuff and try to give us stuff, but it can't give us anything we really want. And we're just looking at that. Belief cannot give us what we really want. Never. Impossible. And then we kind of shudder and say, whew, I want to back away from belief here a little bit. Let me back away a little more. And then, of course, each time we back away from belief, we think that threatens belief to the extent that belief will then give us what we really want, and which we keep engaging then. You know, we re-engage with belief, and because we recognize that belief has been severely threatened. And we believe that when something's severely threatened, it can give us what it's holding out from us. So here's the problem. We believe that we can threaten the Prime Creator to change reality. We believe the Prime Creator can change reality, but it's been holding out on us, refusing to do so. So we believe if we just threaten it enough, this will force the Prime Creator to change reality, which is simply not true. It's impossible. And yet, so that because we want that to be true, when we threaten belief, when we threaten belief by backing away from belief and seeing what is to come and all that, we want it to be so that belief can somehow give us what it's been holding out, can give us what it's been holding, not giving us, you know, that by threatening it, belief will say, okay, here's the result that I've been holding out, not giving you. I had it all along, but I just didn't want to give it to you. But now that you've, you know, threatened me, I've given it to you. In fact, belief wants us to threaten it that way, believing that by doing this, it will somehow cough up the result that we want. It's like belief believes it has the result. See, belief does believe it has a result, it just doesn't know where it is. So it believes if we threaten belief badly enough, it will cough it up. It'll cough it up. Somehow it swallowed it and it can't get it now. It coughs it up and says, oh, here it is. I just was so threatened that I suddenly found it. So to a very tricky extent, belief wants us to threaten it, which is probably the final point of the path, is to see this and recognize that all the attempts to get free of belief, belief is subtly there wanting to be threatened, which feeds into this notion that it has the answer for us. It has what we really want, but we just need to threaten with dropping belief to force it to cough it up for us. And when we recognize it doesn't even have anything to cough up for us, we have no reason to threaten it anymore. That's the end of the path. We drop the path. No more path. That's it. That's the end of it. Then we simply accept what is. We are able to accept everything just as it is because we're not even trying to threaten belief anymore. You see that? This just came up for me the first time I've seen this. That the path itself is a way to try and threaten belief, which is based on the notion of the belief, that belief has something it will cough up for us if it's threatened severely enough. But if we really just accept everything as it is, we're not trying to threaten anything. We're not trying to threaten belief. It means we're not trying to get anything to cough up anything. That's very profound. This just came to me right this moment. I had not seen that before. Never seen that before. Which provides the perfect rationale for actually dropping the path, or as many have said, call off the search. Drop the search. Drop the path. Entirely just drop it. Because the path itself is a subtle, it's a workings of belief too. It's still our desire for belief to give us what we want, to give us the result, to give us the product. And so the path is really just all this effort to threaten belief until we reach the point where we realize that even by the most severe threats of belief will not get it to cough up what we really the product that we really want. It doesn't have it. We'll never have it. We'll never have it. And so then we can just, you know, drop the path altogether. Drop belief, drop the path, and simply abide in effortless unconditional love, which accepts everything as it is. So we were able to in this video to arrive at a very clear picture of the end of seeking, the end of the path. The end of the path ends by recognizing that the whole thing has just been really a subtle attempt to threaten belief. To get it to cough up what we really want, which it doesn't have, but which it believes it has. Yeah. So by reaching this and looking at it, you know, just looking at it, say, okay, that's how I feel right now, okay, I see it, that's great. What will come of this? I don't know. But it's certainly very welcome seeing. It's a very welcome seeing. Because I can see that it's profound. I can see the leverage that it has. I can see how it fits in with what others have said of the dropping the search. Setting it down. Just kind of setting it down willingly, happily, gently, and just saying, aha, now I see what's been going on, so now I can just set it down. Easy. piece of cake. The setting down doesn't have to be a way of trying to threaten belief. Just kind of a loving setting down as it is, letting everything just be as it is. So this has been a very, very fruitful video to just go in and make the effort. And now I have to basically pair this audio up with some video, some pictures, in order to upload it to YouTube. Cannot just upload an MP3 there. So I'll have to engage with that and get that done. So very great. It's been a great time working on this video here, and I'll work now on getting it out and sharing it with everyone. Okay, that's it for this video.